All right, guys, let's start this DBA brake installation job on the 2015 Forester XT, minus the hood stripe, upcoming grill, vinyl, and dirt. All right, first thing where I jack it up, I haven't done a lot of work on the Forester, really. I'm just kind of winging it. So you could, you know, go from your frame. Your metal frame rail, of course, is standard, but I feel you can also go from right about here. This is fine, it's off the ground. Got my taller jack stands, so that's how I'm gonna jack it up. The wheel, the lugs are already loose, so let me get the wheels off, and then we'll kinda see how we're gonna start this brake conversion. All right, so get some of your prep stuff ready. Got my brake clean, just to clean us off stuff a little bit, just like I did the WRX. Not gonna do anything crazy with this. Have a bungee cord for your caliper. Very first thing, 12. Ugh. As I said, the very first thing is your 14 millimeter to get the caliper off. Usually super easy. It's not that tight. And once you break them loose, you just finger them off. That's what a lot of guys do. They finger them off. Okay, got your two caliper bolts done. That part's easy. Let me get gloves. All right. Caliper off. That's a damn heavy caliper. Hook it on your bungee and you're good to go for now. The line is bolted here. Just don't stretch it too far, all that usual stuff. I'll lower it just a little. There, it's out of the way. All right, remember just the basics. Keep your pads in the right place on your towel that you take them off. This is the outside pad, it'll go out here because you have different pad clips and all that. Only one side has a squeaker. All right, this is the inside one. You can also, of course, tell with the markings, but whatever, just standard practice. Put the pads on the side where you got them off. All right, caliper carrier is gonna be 17s, so let me go get that set up. The top caliper bolt is a little tight in the clearance, so I'm gonna try a 3/8 adapter, see if I can fit it in there. Just barely, and I don't think the socket will crack, but the socket isn't made for this kind of heavy duty work. But it's a little tight with the spindle here to get into this bolt. So you just gotta find the right tools to get in there. Should almost be hands. That's true. You turn it, you just move it in a certain direction and it's all loose. You can get the screws out. Just take the pressure off it, you know. Okay, that's one. Wiggle it, it's so close. I almost got it loose. Dang, that one's tight. Let me just get a few more turns. That should do it. There we go. Okay. Not really that dirty. I am gonna, you know, clean off the straight dirt and grime, but I'm not gonna polish them or nothing like that. If you don't have squeaking or noise, the general rule is don't touch it. Don't touch something that ain't broke. So because the brakes are perfect, I'm not gonna go polish all the metal, have it have to wear in again and get adjusted again. When it builds up some form and patina on it, that's really how it's broken in, and it just is comfortable that way. You polish it up, you're gonna have all shiny surfaces, you may get some noises again. So it's up to you if you wanna go crazy. Now I'm going to get bolts through here and pull off the stock rotor. There we go. All right. Let's do something just for fun now. Let's do the weights. So, power on. I don't think there'll be any difference. Who knows? They both feel pretty dang heavy. I think they're going to be pretty close. Stock rotor weight. I hope I don't break my scale. 21, 7.8. Stock. 21, 7.8. Aftermarket, 21.9. Hell yeah. 7 ounces saved with the aftermarket brake kit. All right, I'll just do some light spray. Get off some of that gunk. You know, you have time now, why not do it? You're not gonna get another opportunity. That's all, I'm just gonna clean off some of the obvious stuff. And I do take a rag for a minute, and I can get off a lot of that brown dirt and stuff, make this black. You know, the key is really don't just rush through the job. Like, you know, enjoy the job. I'm enjoying it. Like, take your time and just look at everything, make everything nice to a point. You're not dealing with a show car here. Just, you know, get off some of that grime if you can. It's a lot better than it was, that's for sure. This car has about 26,000 miles right now. All right. Even though that looks like a rusty hat, it's glass smooth. To my finger, it's glass smooth. It looks rough, but it's not. It's a visual thing. It's literally glass smooth. I'll just wipe off some of the brown gunk, and I'll come back in a minute. All right, now I'm gonna clean the rotor a little bit. Now I know this isn't an optimal towel to use. I'm always out of microfibers. I'm always using them up. So I'm actually using a pretty nice waffle towel. I'm using one of the only clean things I have, which is this waffle towel. All my stuff's always stained. I don't know how you guys keep those microfibers clean. Like, every time I use them, it's oil and grease. Maybe that's the key. I shouldn't be using it for that. And I put them in the wash. It doesn't clean anything. They come out just as stained. And I don't use the fabric sheets and all that. Oops, gotta be careful here. It's gonna pull off the paint. Not that I need it, but be careful. The brake clean will pull off that temperature paint. I'm just getting off that oily gunk that comes on the rotors from the factory to keep them fresh and preserved. You started with the other side because it won't be sitting on the surface. It's sitting on the hat, so you don't corrupt what you just cleaned. And this is the last side I do. That is awesome. Ugh, this thing's heavy. Beautiful. All right, yeah, I'm satisfied. Hell, this isn't even as big a job as the... Oh, my arms. Oh. This isn't as big a job. Whoa, those are awesome. By the way, they were the same exact size. I did check that, I just didn't tell you. Which, of course, I expected. I mean, you can't really go bigger without a proper brake kit and all the wheel input and all that. So, same size. Of course, they're sweet, they're slotted. And the kangaroo paw design. Some people on the channel kind of laugh at all this. This isn't a joke. The fins are in the shape of a kangaroo paw on purpose. Go to the DBA site, you'll see what that does over a standard rotor. It's an important feature. All right, now it's a pain in the butt. I'm gonna clean this whole piece and I'll be back in a bit. Again, some people like to take these out and clean them and everything. I don't like to touch what's not broke. These are perfectly 100% nice, smooth. They're uncontaminated. As soon as you pop them up, you can get a dust speck. You think you're cleaning them, but these are uncontaminated and sealed, and they have perfect movement, so why open them? I mean, yeah, you want it cleaned like factory. If there's something wrong, yeah, there's nothing wrong with these. I'm not gonna open them and expose them to possible contamination. Another thing here, be gentle with your seals, but I'm giving them a little bit of wipe. There's always just a tiny, tiny bit of grease or seep sometimes on these. And it's actually the pad lube most commonly. But I just want to make sure the tips of those pistons are fairly clean, no big grease piles on them. That looks good there. Oops, my rotor's slipping. All right. Finally, I am gonna clean these a little bit better. It's the one thing that I do clean up pretty good. These are pretty dirty. See that in the light? Yeah. Those are pretty dirty, so I'm gonna go ahead and do a little work on these next. All right. Those are nicely cleaned. A lot better than they were, at least. No more big piles of grease and dirt. I'm gonna put a little bit of anti-seize in the right spots here. Here, maybe there, wherever I see some movement and wear. Just a tiny bit to make sure they're good, and I should be ready to go. Now, I'm not saying this is the only right way to do a brake job. I'm just saying this is how I do a brake job. A lot of people might have different ideas and methods. I've been doing brakes since about 1985, and that was training with the master mechanic who taught me a lot of what I know. My first car job before I went to a lot more companies and stuff, and got in the parts industry for a while, things like that. All right, I got it started. No, I didn't, man. It's tricky to get this stuff started. You gotta hold everything together and get it just lined up right. Yeah, I'll be right back. All right, I just had to go take a break and check the torque specs. The carrier is 59 foot-pounds. The caliper is 20 foot-pounds. Got a 59 foot-pound. That's not gonna reach. I'm gonna need some special extensions for that. Let me get the bottom one first. Luckily I had the cortisone shot, because this would be the kind of stuff that screws up my shoulders. Let me get a good angle. That's just creaking. There we go. Okay. Now I need the bolts are in the way there. Maybe a little bit of a wobbly or something. I think I got it. Is that right? Yeah. Okay. Caliper's done. Let's go get those pads. All right, remember again, you do have four different pads in this package. And you can see you have different types of clips on each pad. And the sides matter, because the clips are all at the bottom. So you just reference your other stock pads. Oh, let's see. That's not bad at all, guys. They're almost 30,000 miles, and look how fresh the Forester stock pads are. I mean, obviously they don't need replacement, but this is really a performance replacement. I don't think these stock pads are even half used, but of course that's because she drives it and she does not drive it fast. All right, and important for these pieces, I learned a lot on previous jobs. They rest on this little outside tab right there, and that's to pull the pads away after you brake so they don't drag and slow down the car. So we go in here, put that there,
pry, probably with a screwdriver, and I got it. The inner piece. Right there, real nice. And as you can see, that matches the right clips. Now I'll do the other side, which I'll probably do off camera. I need a light and a tweaker so I can pull this back enough to get the pads in right. It's a little trickier on the inside. Here's a good example of exactly what I was talking about. Those clips are to push your pads out as it turns so it doesn't drag. See that? It does, it works. It pushes itself out and they sit right there on the outsides to say, oh, you're done breaking. Let's release these a little bit. All right, now you are ready to push in your pistons a bit. You do not need to open the bleeder. Don't let people tell you that and let air into the system. Provided you have a lot of room in your reservoir, which of course we do because you don't top it up. If you top up your reservoir every 6 months, you're going to be in trouble because as you push these in, it'll overflow. We've never topped it up. It always keeps its correct height. If you don't do that, you can see it's going back and forth, but it's slowly getting closer. And I hold one, it's easy to hold with your hand, and just about got them both bottomed out. A little bit more. That's probably enough to get it on. It's close though, let me see. There you go. All right. And a nice simple 20 foot-pound for your calipers. You could hold the back, but you don't really need to. It'll just catch when it's ready. I think I want to try a different side here. Okay. Very little for the 20. They're small bolts. Do not strip them out. Don't have much room here. Could go downward. There it is. I don't need to go downward. There we go. All right. Everything done. You've heard it a million times. Don't just throw it in reverse and back out right now. Your pads are loose. Your pedal will sink to the ground. You won't have any brakes. When we do the other side, pump them up nice and hard. Then you're safe to go ahead and pull out. I'm gonna probably just do a few pump bleed on each four corners since I have it open and since I have an assistant somewhere in the house. Just to make sure, might as well take the opportunity while it's ready to go, easy to access. It's been, you know, it hasn't been touched in its whole life. I'll just make sure there's no bubbles that ended up at the ends over all these years. All right, guys, a lot of people like to do their brake job with the auto bleeders, the Motivac, whatever it is. I've had that. I always go back to my tried and true manual method that I, you know, grew up with, the classic, the OG. I'm gonna look at this myself. All right, pump them up and hold them. Look for bubbles right there. Are you ready? You gotta say when. Yeah. Open it a little bit, see if we get anything. Not really, which I didn't expect. I didn't open these systems. One more time. Probably not much to do here. I'll just get some fresh fluid down this way. Yeah, no bubbles at all, really. One more, that's probably good enough. I didn't really need to do this. Okay. Holding it. Yeah, let me do one more. I saw a tiny, tiny bubble, just to make sure. All right, guys, we're gonna do the super official lug nut discussion. No, I'm just kidding. I was doing that Food Channel dude, you know? The guy that has the food, super official, when he tastes like fast food burgers. All right, know what I'm talking about? Remember I bought new lug nuts, black ones, for the WRX a long time ago. I did not install them because they're too beat up and the wheels come off too often on the WRX. I am going to put these on the Forester. Woo! Let me show you the stocky luggies, which are really disgusting. Ow, my knees. Look at these. Crap right there. And these brand new black lugs from eBay. They work fine, they're cheap, about 20 bucks for a set. I got these a long, long time ago, and I just realized today that's gonna really offset my black theme right, and they're ready to go. So they should fit. The WRX had the same style originals. These should fit. I'm gonna go ahead and make sure. Awesome, black lug nut upgrade, mid brake job.